Good evening and welcome to Friday's Look North. Our top story tonight. As England prepare for the World Cup final, we ask what impact it could have for the future of women's football.
Yeah, I've played for many years, but it's seen the growth in women's football. That's everything I wanted it to be when I was a kid.
And we're at the hometown club of the England captain, Millie Bright. This is where it all started, at the Killamarsh Dynamos.
We'll be live as the excitement builds. Also tonight, he was supposed to wait 8 weeks for a cancer op at York Hospital Trust. 9 months on, this man's still waiting. And taking to the stage at Glastonbury, we meet the 18-year-old from Bradford whose festival didn't go quite as expected.
And Storm Betty will bring some heavy and thundery rain out there tonight. Winds will strengthen, but most certainly an improving picture through the weekend. I have the very latest for you towards the end of the programme.
Good evening. Could football finally be coming home? Not since 1966 have England reached a World Cup final, but this weekend the Lionesses will do just that, taking on Spain in the final on Sunday. With five players from Yorkshire and North Derbyshire in the squad, excitement here is building. Captain Millie Bright and Rachel Daly were in the winning team in the semi-final, and both are expected to play again this weekend. Millie's illustrious career started out at Killamarsh Dynamos Football Club near Chesterfield. And our sports reporter Sally Hurst is there for us now. Sally.
That's right. But yes, we're here at the Killamarsh Dynamos. This is where it all started for the England captain, Millie Bright, as you say. And behind me, there's a training session going on with some of the, perhaps the next generation of Millie Brights here. We'll be talking to some of them in a moment. They're doing great stuff here tonight. But first of all, we've been talking to some grassroots players about their excitement about the match on Sunday, and also looking at what impact the Lionesses' success is having on the women's game.
When you guys walk out onto that pitch, it's a moment.
This is Barnsley FC's newest team, the first time in the Tykes' long history that they've had a women's team. And as director Julianne Quay points out, it's about time.
The club is 137 years old. It's kind of shameful that it's taken this long. And literally that is the answer. Why not? Seeing the Lionesses doing well and the Lionesses beating Australia, which you earned, fair play to you, I think that has a huge impact on it.
And again, nice and powerful, nice and strong.
These women have always played football and loved the game, but the success of the Lionesses has turned their sport from a hobby into a possible career.
Just make sure you use all the area. Off you go.
All the young girls now in whatever area in the country are watching them and are aspiring to be one of the Lionesses, and that's what we're doing as well. We're trying to be role models to showcase what we can do and what girls now, 6-7 year old, can be and how they can develop moving forward.
When I was a kid, we didn't have the pathways for girls' football that there is now. So to see them win the Euros last year was amazing, and then hopefully on Sunday we can bring home the World Cup. So, yeah, I've played for many years, but it's seen the growth in women's football. That's everything I wanted it to be when I was a kid.
An increase in the number of under 16 girls playing in football in England since they won the Euros. So it really has had a very positive impact in the short term. I would say in the longer term, whether that increased participation is going to be sustained, it's probably too early to make some firm conclusions on that.
Final, despite the time difference in Australia making weekday viewing tricky. But in Millie Bright's hometown, businesses are getting ready for a big weekend.
We're really, really excited. Millie has been fantastic. We know her from ages. I think I know her from 15 years maybe now. She's been such an inspiration. So really ecstatic about it. So thrilled that she's there. Every time we saw her on telly, you know, feel like we know somebody special. She's making us so proud.
And where are you going to be watching?
I bought a new telly, actually, a big screen just for this. I always wanted to buy it, but I think this is the occasion I don't want to miss.
Well, Alt Buntings will be going up tomorrow. There'll be Alt Buntings outside. Some of the customers are putting food on. We're opening at 10 o'clock, and there's going to be a lot here, so it'll be a really exciting day. And they're definitely going to win.
With 2 days to go until the biggest game in their history, the Lionesses can be certain of support back home.
Come on, England! Well, that training session is well underway tonight, and joining me now is Mike Atherton, who's the chair of the Killamarsh Dynamos. And you actually knew Millie Bright. What was she like when she first came here onto this playing field?
Well this is where Millie first came. She was only little. You know, if Andy Poulsen, who was a manager, would say that she was, he called her a dot. So, but she was a very energetic dot. He said that when she started, or when they started, he was on his own doing the training, but she was constantly helping him.
And so, could you see instantly her skills?
Absolutely. Yeah, she, during the sort of first year that she was with us, she played up front. And I think she scored 80 goals in that first season. And she was obviously always destined to go, you know, onwards and upwards.
But she's never forgotten her roots, has she?
Absolutely not. No, she comes back. All the family still live in the village. But when Millie comes up here, she brings memorabilia that we can, you know, use for the benefit of the club, for the benefit of the kids. And yeah, she did take them all down to St George's Park to meet the England team, which, you know, these girls will never forget that, you know. So.
An unforgettable moment. Absolutely. For them, yeah. Absolutely. Thank you, Mike. And Sarah Woods here from the FA in Sheffield. And Sarah, have you seen an impact after Lioness's success on girls wanting to come and join groups like this?
Yeah, absolutely. I think after the Euros last year, there was such a massive impact on the game. We've spent a lot of work locally, putting the foundations in place, working with volunteers, grassroots football clubs, schools, to provide the opportunities for girls, and we're now seeing that happen, and it's great. We've got another tournament where the Lionesses have been successful as well.
There's still a long way to go, though, isn't there? Because we do have the infrastructure, but sometimes girls and women are still fighting to get their space on the training pitches.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, there is a long way to go. We've put some really good measures in place already. There are more opportunities for girls to get involved in football, whether that's in a team such as this one here, or whether it's in a Wildcats programme, for example. We're working with education sites as well for equal access for girls. So, yeah, the opportunities are coming slowly but surely. But, yeah, we're working with different people to help provide more opportunities.
And I suppose the challenge is trying to keep it going a bit longer term, especially as you say that there's still work to be done to get football for girls in schools.
Yeah, definitely in schools. We work really closely with our education partners around the region, and they provide lots of opportunities for girls to play football. We've seen more schools now provide lunchtime clubs, after-school clubs, and we just want to keep motivating people and encouraging them to do that, because that's potentially a girl's first opportunity of playing football, and we want it to be a positive experience in school.
Sarah, thank you very much. Well, we will be talking to some of these girls behind me later in the programme, but for now, it's back to you in the studio.
Thanks, Sally. Now, on to the rest of the day's news. And a man from Selby says he's losing faith in the NHS after waiting nearly 9 months for cancer treatment. Andrew Batty says constant delays are causing him extreme stress and worry. And from his perspective, the system seems broken. He says it hurts him to speak out because he used to work for the health service himself. Cathy Killick reports.
Andrew Batty has to take great care when shaving these days. He has a basal cell carcinoma, a type of skin cancer, on his top lip. He saw his doctor in December last year and a specialist soon after. He was referred for surgery to remove it and was told it would be done within 6 to 8 weeks. Nearly 9 months later, he's still waiting.
It's very stressful. This is a fairly minor skin cancer. If it's treated early, it's one of the most treatable forms of skin cancer that you can have. The longer it's left, the more chance there is of it turning into something nastier, and the more it can grow and the bigger it gets, the more they've got to cut out and the more disfiguring potentially.
The ongoing delays are particularly hard for Andrew to bear because he's gone through something similar already. He told Look North in March how delays to precisely timed eye injections he needs to stop him going blind have already affected his eyesight. Not great for an artist. Yet more struggling to get treatment is affecting his mental health.
It makes you feel quite ill sometimes with stress, with all the backwards and forwards with emails and telephone calls and just not getting anywhere. It's just constant delays. I feel like it's a battle with the NHS. The NHS should be battling for me, but I feel to be battling with the NHS to get the treatment that I need.
Is there anyone or anything you blame for this situation?
I think it's just the whole NHS system at the moment, really. It doesn't help with all the strikes that have been going on. unrelated to this, I have had one appointment cancelled due to industrial action for a different thing.
Although striking NHS staff have maintained emergency cover, non-urgent patients have paid a price and will continue to do so as pay disputes continue. A spokesperson for York and Scarborough NHS Trust has apologised for the stress and inconvenience Andrew has suffered and said in a statement, "It's well documented that the pandemic impacted on patient care, particularly waiting times for planned operations. The strikes have also impacted on waiting times. All patients on the waiting list are clinically reviewed and we're prioritising patients on the basis of clinical urgency." Nationally, more than 400,000 cancer patients have waited longer than they should have for treatment, so sadly, Andrew's not alone. But that's no comfort to him or others similarly affected. Cathy Killick, BBC Look North, Selby.
There's hope tonight that at least some parts of the Worksop-based homewares chain Wilko will be taken over. That's according to the GMB union. Their national secretary confirmed there had been expressions of interest in the business, adding that talks with potential buyers were still at an early stage. Well, Phil Bodmer is here with me. Just remind us how we got to this point, Phil.
Well, if you cast your mind back just over a week ago, Brigid, you'll know that Wilko announced it was going into administration with the risk of 12,500 jobs potentially that could be lost. There are 37 branches of Wilko in our region alone. Of course, the important thing is it had its head office in Worksop, which employs about 400 people, and a major distribution centre there, which employs up to 8,000 people. Now, according to the GMB union tonight, they are saying that there are genuine grounds for hope that at least parts of the business could be saved. Now, PricewaterhouseCoopers are the administrators. They were appointed to receive expressions of interest in the business from viable organisations that may wish to take over. Now, part of its job as an administrator is to seek the best possible line for its creditors. So, and that's obviously okay. The situation we're in now.
And do we know who the potential buyers might be?
We don't. There is lots of speculation out there, as you might imagine. Among them, B&M, Poundland, they could be possible buyers, but both companies declined to speak to the BBC when approached yesterday. At the moment, all 400 Wilko shops will continue to trade. The workers will continue to get paid. However, it is unlikely that every single shop will be saved.
Phil, thanks very much. 128 dogs are reported to have had their ears cropped in West and South Yorkshire in the last 3 years, putting our region as one of the worst places in the country for the practice. Ear cropping involves removing part of a dog's ear for cosmetic reasons. The RSPCA says it's a cruel and unnecessary procedure, which is carried out to make a dog look tough. It is illegal in England. Organisers of the Hillsborough Park Run in Sheffield say they're devastated to have to cancel the event until further notice. They say they can't guarantee runners' safety because of work to repair Hillsborough Park after the Tramlines Festival. The park has been largely out of action since it was badly damaged when heavy rain hit the festival in July. The main road between Leeds and Harrogate has reopened fully today ahead of schedule. Waterproofing, resurfacing and repairs have been taking place on Harewood Bridge on the A61 since the Grade 2 listed bridge was shut 3 weeks ago. Next tonight, the Rail Minister has told Look North that the government's £3 billion upgrade to the Transpennine Rail Line will deliver a better train network for Yorkshire. Hugh Merriman also said the government is reconsidering a plan to build a new mainline rail station in Bradford, a proposal that had been scrapped by the Prime Minister last autumn. Mr Merriman was in Huddersfield today opening a new rail safety centre, as David Rhodes reports.
They are a vital part of the transport network, but each year nearly 4,000 workers are injured trackside in a bid to keep our trains running. Over the next decade, thousands of people will work on upgrading the Manchester to York rail line. And today in Huddersfield, the Rail Minister opened a new £3 million immersive safety training centre, the first of its kind in the north.
We want to remove the dangers of accidents and incidents that take place and make sure that people feel secure and comfortable in their work. And if they do that, they'll be more efficient in their work as well.
Like the rail network in Yorkshire, not everything goes to plan.
So, I declare the centre.
Contract changes and industrial action mean that in the latest annual figures, barely half of all TransPennine Express trains have run on time, making the operator one of the worst performing in England.
It's become easier to travel when the train drivers are on strike these days than it is when they're not on strike.
It's gone back into government control, but I'm seeing no improvement in the service.
Everyone wants a safer railway, but here in the north we want a railway that actually works. TransPennine's 50% of their trains are late. What do you say to that? When is the North going to have a rail network that actually works, Minister?
Well, that's exactly why we're spending more money on the TransPennine route upgrade than has been spent on the Elizabeth line, to make sure that there is that resilience in the North. It will give more train paths, longer platforms, better trains and a faster service. It will reduce from 55 minutes from Manchester to York down to 41 minutes. So that's all really positive and it's being built right now.
Bradford was promised a mainline station on an upgraded TransPennine line. The government then cancelled it, but a U-turn might now be on the cards.
We are working on that right now with our partners in the Department for Levelling Up and also with the team in Bradford. So I very much hope that we can deliver better for Bradford.
So Bradford's back in the game. So the government now are working with us on plans to realise that connectivity, which is better than where we were out of it completely. So working with them positively over the next month or two about workshops, coming up with a business case to see how we get that investment into Bradford to connect us to mainline railway is really positive for us.
The Rail Minister has set out today long-term ambitions for our region's train network. Commuters, though, will no doubt want short-term improvements. David Rhodes, BBC Look North, Huddersfield.
Now, imagine being in the crowd at Glastonbury, dreaming of one day performing there live on stage. Next thing you know, you're suddenly right up there doing an impromptu gig. Sounds like the stuff of dreams, doesn't it? But it's exactly what happened to 18-year-old James Spencer from Bradford. We'll hear from James in a moment, but first, take a look at this. James, you can tell you're living your dream there on stage. How did it come about that you played a set at Glastonbury?
So me and John, we've been in the band for a couple of years now, and we were helping George with his coup, volunteering at the kids' field, giving kids an opportunity to play instruments. And George, through his time at Glastonbury's, developed a connection with people who work for stages, and he heard of someone dropping out, and he suggested us, and in 24 hours, two rehearsals outside a camper van with no instruments plugged in, we managed to scrape a set together.
George, how common is it for this to happen? You've worked at Glastonbury for many years. Is this rare, or does it happen all the time?
It's pretty rare, because most of the acts are booked well in advance, or a venue won't have an act unless they're known or recommended. And in this particular case, because I've got a good working relationship with this venue, they said, do you know of any good acts? I said, I do, actually. He's part of my crew. OK, we trust you, let's give it a shot. And it was just brilliant. James nailed it. And at that time of night that he played, I mean, the venue holds about 1,000 people. It doesn't normally get busy till 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning, but at 9:30 it was steaming. It was brilliant.
Amazing. John, you're the drummer.
Yes.
OK, so suddenly you're in this position. What was it like playing in front of all those people at Glastonbury without having heard yourself together before?
It was incredible. It was such a moment. I think, you know, after working hard and you know, working towards something, having it drop on you in the moment, you know, almost in the best possible way at the best possible gig, it was crazy. We had fun though. We managed to get a band together. The 24 hours leading up to the gig was, we were all buzzing, you know.
But it must have been difficult with no rehearsal time, really.
I mean, it was difficult, but we were surrounded by great musicians, so all of George's volunteers were all musicians in order to teach the kids. So they were able to pick up the music pretty quickly. So I think as well, the opportunity sometimes, when it's there, you work towards it no matter what you have to do.
Yes, yes.
And I mean, I think we did that.
Absolutely right. James, what's the future for the band? I mean, you started at the top.
So I think just to carry on the momentum, I mean, playing at Glastonbury is honestly an incredible dream. It's a dream come true. So we've got a couple of songs coming out on the 6th of September, our next song's out, and we just want to carry on the momentum, gain a following, hopefully play some bigger places, and yeah.
Any other venues you'd like to
love to play Leeds Fest, love to play, you know, O2 Academy in Leeds, anywhere local, it'd be brilliant.
Well, congratulations, so exciting and amazing, and the stuff of dreams, really the stuff of dreams. We wish you the best of luck for the future.
Thanks for coming in.
Dreams do come true, and now let's get back to our top story and the England dream, because the countdown is on. Kick-off in Sydney on Sunday is 11 a.m. our time, when England's Lionesses take on Spain in the World Cup final. Our sports reporter Sally has spent the day in Killamarsh and joins us now from Captain Millie Bright's first club, the Killamarsh Dynamos. Sally, how's the mood there?
I think they're all pretty excited. We'll talk to some of them, shall we? Some of the girls have stopped their training, which, you know, they're pretty serious about it, to come and talk to me. What is it that you love about football, and how long have you been in this club?
I've been in this club since the start of the season, and I just love football because I've been playing it since I could walk. So. Yeah.
And what do you think about the Lionesses?
I think they're doing really well, and hopefully they can win this match.
Any predictions for Sunday?
Probably, I don't know, 3-1.
What about you? Have you been watching? Where are you going to be watching on Sunday?
On Sunday we're going to be watching it in club, like we did, like every time anyone's come down now, and we're going to hopefully be cheering them all on, because when they win.
It's fun, I guess, to watch with all your team as well, especially because Millie Bright came from this club. Who are your favourite players?
Millie Bright, because I play same position as her, and she's like such a role model to watch, and it's really like it helps you to improve on what you need to improve on, and see what you could be like when you're older.
And do you think you could make it to the England team? Is that an ambition for you?
Well, I'm going to really try to, because Millie Bright started here and then she's got up there, so I think anyone in this team can do it too.
That is a can-do attitude I like. What about you? Who are your favourite players?
My players are Lucy Bronze.
And why is that?
Because I really like where she plays, because I play in that position sometimes, and I really like her goals as well.
Well, shall we have some more predictions? What about you? What's your prediction for Sunday?
I feel like it'll be a tough game, but I feel like we'll actually like conquer them and get to a 2-1 score.
And what about you? What's your bet for Sunday, the score?
Well, it's going to be a really tough game, the two finalists, but I feel like we could win 3-2.
3-2? What about you?
I feel like we could win maybe 3-1, but it 3-1. Depends how energetic.
What about you?
Like 2-1, because I know they've got some, like, we've got Lucy Bronze from Barcelona, and they've got some of the top class players from teams like Barcelona and that, so.
It's going to be competitive, isn't it? But they're all predicting a win here. Well, we've got some other good luck messages from across the region. Let's have a look at those now.
It's going to be 3-0. Come on, Lionesses.
100% win. It's against Spain, and, well, we have to try our best.
Been brilliant watching them throughout the whole journey.
Ella Toon! Yeah!
We're the Lionesses, and we hope you bring us the cup back home.
When I go on the pitch to play, I want to be them.
I want to get on the pitch with them, to be honest, if I could. It makes me want to play football even more.
Rousseau!
Well, I absolutely cannot wait for that game on Sunday. The kickoff is 11 o'clock. It's live on BBC One with build up from 9:45. So from the Killamarsh Dynamos, we've got a message for them, haven't we?
Come on, England!
Thank you, Sally. Stirring stuff. Right, it's time for the weather. Is the weather stirring stuff?
Yes, it is, actually. So we've got Storm Betty on the way out there tonight. It's going to be very unsettled. Some heavy and potentially some thundery rain. Could get some hail mixed in there too. But today's not been too bad. It's just been mostly cloudy through much of the day. But for many of us, it's been mostly dry. Just a chance of the odd spot of drizzle here and there. This photo was taken first thing this morning. You can see cloudy skies. And the second photo, oh, this is my second photo. I picked this because of the sunflowers. Sunflowers really brightened that up quite nicely. So keep those pictures coming. You can send them via Twitter or Instagram or head to our Weather Watchers website. So out there for the rest of tonight, it is going to turn very unsettled, some potentially heavy and thundery rain on the way. Could get some big hail mixed in there too. But the good news is Storm Betty should clear by the time we get into tomorrow morning. So it's this deepening area of low pressure working its way in from the southwest. As I mentioned, that area of low pressure should clear by tomorrow morning. So actually an improving picture over the weekend. Lots of questions about the football day on Sunday. It's actually going to be the better day of the weekend, mostly dry with lengthy spells of sunshine. So we start off on a mostly cloudy note through this evening, and here is that heavy rain. You can see the green in that rain indicates the sharpest burst, the heaviest burst, and our winds will strengthen too. And notice our temperatures tonight down to around 16 degrees, so it's going to be very mild into tomorrow morning. Now, a quick look ahead to our high waters. We've got Scarborough at 6:38 in the morning and again at 7:04 tomorrow night. So tomorrow morning is going to be a lovely start to the day. There's going to be some spells of sunshine around. A bit of patchy cloud will build through the afternoon, but patchy is the key word, broken, to still allow for those sunny spells. And I think apart from one or two isolated showers, for many of us it should stay mostly dry, but it is going to stay quite breezy. In those sunny spells, it's going to be feeling fairly pleasant. Temperatures tomorrow up to around 23 degrees. And then all eyes on Sunday, football day. I think it's going to most certainly be the better day of the weekend. So mostly dry through the day, a bit of cloud first thing, but there'll be increasing amounts of sunshine through the rest of the day, and it is going to stay mostly dry, and our winds will fall much lighter too. It does stay settled through Monday as well. The best of the sunshine towards the end of the afternoon into the evening, but we're just going to get through tonight. Bit of a blip with Storm Betty on the way.
Thanks, Katerina. Well, thankfully the sun's going to shine for England. We're back at 10:30. Phil will be here with the late news. Until then, have a very good evening. Nice to meet you.